his shield. And he just stabbed me, and I stabbed him, and we were sort of over the top of each other. And so I looked through the person's chair, and I went, "That's me."
That's awesome.
And they honestly, they went like this, they went, I actually took a photo of the screen and posted it on Twitter. It was funny. They didn't believe me.
That's sad.
Two things. One, out of all the films and movies that you've done, which one did you have the most fun filming?
It's funny you should say that, because you know there's always something you can extract from any series, which was my movie, which makes you reflect on what's fun. I think one of the real special occasions was I did a movie called The Condemned, which is a WWE movie. As a matter of fact, I met one of those twins, the twins that are downstairs, and one of them's married to John. Oh, his boy girlfriend, I should say, married. Don't tweet that. She's going out with John Cena. So I did a movie with John Cena called The Marine. And then the WWE came back to Australia to shoot another film. And it was funny, I was actually at the gym, and a friend of mine came up and goes, "Money, you're going to go audition for that WWE film?" And I said, "What WWE film?" And he said, "Oh, they're doing another one here." And I'm at my agent, and I said, "They're doing another one." And she said, "Oh, well, you've already made him one. I don't think they'll cast you in another one." And so I changed my hair, and I said, "Look, Tom, just to take a look at me." And so I went in, and it wouldn't have happened if I hadn't chased it up. And finally, I went in, and I had a different look. My hair was longer, and I kind of got to the gym and did I was pretty ripped. And so, who's seen The Condemned? Yeah, people talk about Spartacus and stuff like that. The Condemned, I was in my best shape ever. I really worked hard and ate a lot. You got to eat a lot. Eat steaks, big steaks, and you go, but you get big, If you want to be as big as a bull, you've got to eat a bull. So I got a good shape for that, and it was fun, that movie, because we shot on this island. It was called The Condemned, and it was about a bunch of prisoners who get thrown onto an island and have to fight to the death, and it's all televised live to a world audience. But when we were doing the helicopter flying around the island, up in this room, one of those big Bell helicopters that they used in the Vietnam War, and they're classic helicopters. They've got a completely, like any helicopter pilot will tell you that flying in one of those is like it goes, like you hear in the movies, like that big sound. And we're going across the top of the water, and there was like sharks and stingrays, and this whole island was like alive with sharks. And then they said, "Okay, we're going to drop you guys over in the water." Because I don't know whether you remember in that film, but we jumped out of the helicopter into the water below. And I said, "I'm not jumping out." "Look, shark." And I said, yeah, but we've got guys in the water with these sticks. And I'm like, "Well, they're like those clowns in the bull ring. They're not always effective, man." But that was a fun movie. Spartacus was just awesome. Spartacus was awesome. I gotta tell you, that show was extraordinary on so many levels of performance. Not just from the acting, but from all of the people who put their heart and soul into the costuming and the set designs and the writing and the music. I mean, that thing really came together so well. Every time I watch that show, I get so emotional about how well executed it was on all levels and the wonderful people that I got to work with. Let's move on. It's all fun.
Is there any way you can give a shout-out to one of my friends who
can make it
here because
they don't have
money?
It would have to be really loud for them to hear us. Okay, bring your camera up here. Aww. Everyone, we're all gonna yell out, right? What's their name?
His name is
Ashton. Ashton, can I call them?
Oh. You better answer the phone.
We're gonna play with this. This is fun. How can we screw with him? Anybody got suggestions? Come on. Crowd participation, any ideas?
That's coming over.
Yeah. You're coming over. I'll call her for dinner, so.
It's ringing.
you have failed this city.
Some of your inspirations for how to portray him, and what are some of the martial arts influences on him in your portrayal?
Yeah, look, I mean, simply to put it, with Arrow, it was a totally different experience for me with fighting, because the Canadian stunt union is very strong, and so they pretty much demand that when it turns into a fight scene, the stunt guy steps in. And I was totally unused to that, because in New Zealand I did all of my fighting on Spartacus. All of it, maybe 1% of it went to a double when I wasn't available to go onto a scene. They wanted to do wide shots. But whenever it was in close on Spartacus, it was always me. When I got to Canada, they had a different approach. Well, it might have been my fault. Okay. Does anybody know about my audition for Arrow?
Yes. You choked the guy out.
You don't know. Put your hand up if you don't know.
No, I know.
Okay. Right. So, my audition for Arrow goes like this. I was in Kuwait, visiting the special forces. Visiting the U.S. military. Any U.S. military guys here?
Spouse.
And women, guys and girls. Yeah. Fantastic. Qualified. Anyway, so we got to go up there for a USO trip, and we visited the troops. And when I was there, I was really fascinated by all these young men that were in the throes of going to war. Some for the first time, some, you know, doing return missions. And having had played a warrior in a couple of different shows, I was very interested in getting into the mindset of some of these soldiers and these warriors. So I purposefully went around trying to find out who had experience and who was badass. You know, I literally asked, you know, I went up to some of the major guys and I said, listen, like, who's Rambo? You know, which guy here, like, knows his shit and jumps off cliffs into trees and slows himself up and blows away everybody? And they said, well, actually, that guy over there called Knight. And he was this older guy with bald head and, you know, he was, like, I would never have looked at this guy and thought he was that badass. But he, I had a few conversations with him. I'm not going to go into details, but I had this one discussion with him about when he goes into covert ops and he has to go in and, you know, they have to shoot dogs. They shoot the dogs from perimeters. You know, they have to shoot the dogs because the dogs will bark, and they come in and they take out the guards and stuff like that. And he showed me a chokehold. Because I said, you know, when you're going in stealth mode, you know, what are you going to do? And he said, you know, I've got to come in behind guys and take them out. And so he put me in this chokehold. And he said, oh, it's really simple. You just go like this and they're gone. And he grabbed me and put me in. And I was like, as soon as he, you know, I was like straight away. And I was somehow I had the survival mechanism kick in. And so I grabbed him by the balls. And I grabbed him as hard as I could. Because suddenly, I noticed something kicked in. And it's funny because Knight never shows anything in his face today. And afterwards he went, mmm. He told me later he couldn't feel himself for like a day and a half. But he would have taken me out, you know. All he wanted to do was apply a little bit more pressure and it would have all caved in. So he showed me this move. And then when I left, the boys had been giving me some 5-hour energy drink when I was in Kuwait, because I'd flown there from New Zealand. And they have it in their packs, just in case they end up in a big firefight that goes on for 24, 48 hours. They'll have this, because sometimes you've got to stay awake, you know, they're forced to. So this helps them. And when I was there, they said, you've got jet lag, man, just have one of these. And they put it out of their pack. Everyone's got one. So Knight gave me one as I left the airport. And he said, yeah, to remember me by. And I really had no idea, like it was funny, it was a funny thing because they'd been giving me these things and I thought, that's funny. And he gave it to me, he said, to remember me by, and I took it. I got to LA and I was only there for 3 days. I was flying back for the Hobbit premiere. On the third day, my manager rings me in the morning and says, Manu, what time's your flight? And I said, well, it leaves in 4 hours. She said, I need you to go to an audition. I said, I'm gonna go to the airport, like in 4 hours. She goes, just go straight there. It's for this show called Arrow. I was like, you might know this, but I'd met Stephen Amell. He flew to New Zealand, and he was one of the three people who auditioned to replace Andy Whitfield for Spartacus. And so I'd met Stephen that one time. He didn't get that role, and then but he was right for Arrow. But I'd seen his billboards up, and I thought, oh, there's that guy. And so when this call came, I was like, just sort of pennies dropped, and I went, oh, that guy on the billboard, I know him. And sure, let's do it. So they said the script would be ready for me when I got there. So I go down to this casting agency in Los Angeles, and I go in, and there's all these guys that are walking around, it was so funny. Everyone was really trying to be like Slade Wilson, you know? So they were walking around like this, there was like 20 guys just going, mm. I said, hey. I forgot one bit. Just before I went in, when I arrived, I still had really bad jet lag, right? And I got there and I actually wasn't feeling. Like, I got to park my car outside and I went, oh, I just don't really feel like. And I went, oh, the 5-hour energy drink that Knight gave me. I'm telling you, when I went in for my audition for Arrow, I was on Mirakuru. Because I took that bad boy and I chucked it down before I went in, and probably even before I walked through the door, I was going like, mm. And so I got in there, and all these guys are doing this business that they were doing, actors, you know, doing all this stare down stuff to themselves. And I started reading this script, and it actually didn't say Slade, it was something like Washington or something. And it said, you know, this character drops down from the roof of the fuselage and jumps up behind Oliver and grabs him in a chokehold. Chokehold. Mirakuru kicking in. I should be able to do a chokehold. And there it is. Let's make this real. And I could hear these guys that were doing the audition, and there was this one line in particular that was, the line was, you've got 10 seconds to tell me something I believe, kid, or I'm gonna cut out your throat box. And I heard these variations coming from inside the room, and I was just ticking off, going, he's not gonna get it, he's not gonna get it. He's a bit over the top. We hear this, oh, I'm gonna cut out your throat box. And he didn't get it. I'm just sitting there, and I finally, they come in and I say, okay, Manu, and I said, come on in. So I walk in, and the cameraman's about where you are, and he's the director, casting director, and he goes, like, okay, Manu, you ready for this? And I said, yeah, sure, but can the guy behind you that's doing the reading, this guy here, can he come forward in front of the camera so I can hold him in the chokehold in front of the camera? So I don't want to just pretend. Is that okay? And at this stage, my Mirakuru, my 5-hour, I was owning this place. Get him out of here right now, please. So come forward. No, the guy with the Arrow shirt on. I especially want to demonstrate this one here. So yeah, here, come on. So, So the guy says, okay, you're ready to go. And I swear to you, I was back in Kuwait with Knight, remembering this chokehold. And I said, yeah, I'm ready to go. Let's do it. And so I grabbed this guy, and you've got to get your arm around and it locks onto the other arm. This forearm becomes like right on the wind box. And they said, okay, they're wrong, but I'd already started to squeeze. And so they said, okay, in action. And like, there's a few lines up first, and so it took a little bit of time, then I got to the line and went, you got 10 seconds to tell me something I believe in, or I'm going to cut out your throat box. At which point, this guy collapsed. And at first I thought I hadn't read the scene right. And I said, is this part of the scene? And the casting director said to me, no, I think he choked you now. And I said, hey kid, you okay? You okay about that? And he was like, he started waking up. And I said, come on, jump up, man, jump up. And the casting director said, you better go to the bathroom and wash your face with some cold water. And so the kid went off. Nice to meet you, buddy. So he's busy girlfriend. Okay, thanks mate. So the guy's out cold, gets up, has to go wash his face, and I'm sitting in Hollywood thinking I'm never going to come back to this town again. And I said to the casting director, I'm so sorry, man. I literally just came back in Kuwait and I met this guy of Special Forces and he showed me a chokehold and obviously it works. And the casting director went, it was perfect. I said, really? He said, yeah, come and have a look. So we went to the back and we went to the playback and you see this guy's eyes go. I swear to you, it's on film. So they've got it. I've got it somewhere. I hope they release it one day. Just so you can see how ridiculous it was. But yeah, so that's what happened. I don't know, the rest of the stuff, by choreographers, teachers, and we get around all that stuff. Yeah, thanks.
First off, thank you for making it the best day of my life. And my question is, in season 2, yeah, there was a blooper reel where you were putting a Deathstroke costume on for the first time, and then you started breaking out into the most funniest dance ever.
Yeah. When I was 15, I actually wrote a breakdancing book with a good friend of mine, and we released it in Australasia. I earned a $20,000 royalty check when I was 15. It arrived in the post and I went out and I bought this Commodore, Holden Commodore in Australia, and I drove to school in this thing and the headmaster thought I'd stolen it. And I was like, you know, on my P-plates in this killer car. No, I did some breakdancing and when I put that suit on for the first time, I was thinking, I've got to do something classic here, you know. And so I said to the guys, I said to the camera crew, hey listen, when we get to the end of this scene, can you just keep rolling? I'm going to just try to break out something, you know. And so they kept rolling, and that's what I did. And I didn't really have anything in my head choreographed or anything like that. I just came up with that little move. Yeah, but it was good. Who's seen it? The dancing and the Deathstroke.
Can you show us?
If you haven't seen it, jump on your YouTube and look up Deathstroke dancing. And it's quite classic. Awesome. I put the mask on, and there's to the, you know, you know the scene where I just put the guns in, it was like, and I put everything on, and I put the mask on. And then it showed this sort of wide shot, and I was standing there just kind of this, and I went, you gotta look at it online. It's fun.
Thank you so much.
It's not what you'd expect from Deathstroke.
What is that mask like? Is it great to wear? Is it empowering?
Yeah, you know, I mean, costumes are really, you know, when you get dressed up as, I mean, there must be a harlequin in here, isn't there? How many different sort of characters we've got in here? You know, when you put on a costume, you actually sort of exit yourself and you become part of that character. You know, it's part of sort of mask work, you know, comedy dell'arte, old dramatic kind of, you know, plays and performing with masks and costumes, you know. So when I put that on, it's pretty badass, you know. But it's not really the only thing about it is it's quite light, you know, because it's all made out of like, you know, polycarbonate, kind of really light materials, rubber and stuff. So people look at it and they go, oh man, that must be heavy because it's like a military whole outfit, you know. It looks like that, but it's actually made of very light materials.
You're right. I really thought it was very heavy. All right, you're up.
Hi, I have a question and a request. The question is, you don't have to do the question. It'll be awesome if you do. The question is, in a fight out of your characters, who do you think would win? Azog, the Defiler, Crixus, or Deathstroke?
Well, it's did you ever see Raiders of the Lost Ark? Because Deathstroke can just go. Yeah, he come running across the battle and you're and I sort of go, yeah. Weapons are very important.
I'd ask you to call my brother, but he probably wouldn't answer because it's me. But
we've done the cold thing. Yeah. Sorry, darling.
Would you mind doing the Crixus gladiator cry?
Oh. Sure. When I'm rallying them? You mean outside the Roman gates?
When he comes out into the arena and he's like, let's get this started.
Oh, that one, Capua.
Yes.
Okay, whatever. Let me get into it. I used to run around the stadium, like the film set, like before I did my scenes usually, to try to get myself, and I'm Maori, so I'd do all my karakia and stuff like that before I'd get into the mindset of the warrior, so I can't go through that whole process. So this is only a half-assed effort of that, basically. But it was like I'd come out and I'd take in this whole audience, right, and I'd just go, I wouldn't be able to talk for 2 days.
Hello.
Oh, hi.
In Arrow.
Come up here. Come sit a bit. We're getting a live telecast, so you're going to be on television. If you watch Comic-Con TV, you'll be on television. Come and sit up here.
In Arrow.
Up here.
The first time you take off the eye patch, did you realize that it was going to be so creepy looking?
Are you talking about the hole in my head? Yeah, it was funny how they did that. Hey. See, when I did it, right, I was sitting in front of that monitor, because I just planted all the little video cameras inside the Queen Mansion, and I was sitting there looking at all the monitors that were showing, you know, their household, so I could do a peekaboo. And so, in order to do that special effect, I had to sit completely still. Because if you move at all, every single frame that's being shot will need to be altered. You know, it's harder for them to make the special effect if there's any movement, because then they have to actually move the special effect. It's difficult. So I had to just sit there really still with my eye patch on. Do you want to have a staring competition? See who blinks first, go on. Cut one eye. You blink. Thanks for coming. You look pretty gory, eh? Because you can sort of like see into my brain and stuff. But it was, I'm glad I didn't have to do that too many times because I would have had to sit there frozen. No worries. What was your name?
Elizabeth.
Elizabeth. Thanks, Elizabeth.